Hello, everybody. Welcome to Elite Wine TV. Hello, everybody. Welcome to Elite Wine TV. I'm your host, Mark Fusco, here for another special edition of the show. I'm here with Christian Palmaz at Palmaz Vineyards, and he's been kind enough to give me some time today to go through this amazing technologically amazing winery, and also allow to me to start over. We hadn't gotten to the wine. I didn't hit the record on the little thing here. And with the acoustics in here, probably really needed to make sure we had the lavaliers going instead of trying to rely on the microphone on the camera. So one of those rare second takes I occasionally do. But anyway, so we're here for that. Amazing winery. And let's, again, go back into history. Who are you and how did you get here?
My name is Christian Palmaz. I'm the president of Palmaz Vineyards. Originally, we're from Argentina. My father, interventional radiologist, invented the balloon expandable stent, and the process of making the stent a reality is really what brought us to the United States. And so it just so happened that he chose to do his residency at UC Davis. And so we landed very near here, and mom and dad back then spent every waking minute of their free time in Napa Valley.
Right.
Fell in love with the valley at perhaps one of its most charming eras, you know, when it wasn't as commercialized back in the early 80s. And then his medical research took us to San Antonio, Texas, where he worked at the UT Health Science Center and furthered the research, and finally FDA approval. And then ultimately allowed us to kind of circle back and fall back in love with Napa Valley. And after many years of searching, my parents were able to uncover this wonderful property with this very rich history, and
right.
And we were able to sort of build the dream.
So before we get into the history, you told me it took a while to even just decide upon this property. You're looking all over the world, is that right?
Well, we were. You have to realize the change that had occurred from the early 80s to the mid-90s in Napa Valley. Everything had been found by the mid-90s. So it was so rare and so precious to stumble upon a property that had greatly retained 100% of its original footprint from pre-Prohibition era. And it was an absolute treasure to be able to get to be the stewards of this property for the next era.
Okay.
And so I'll tell you a little about the history. So
yeah.
the property originally was founded by a man named Henry Hagen. He German immigrant, moves to the United States and here to San Francisco, and comes up to Napa to establish a wine operation, and basically just buys all the land following this creek up into Mount George. There's a lot of elevation change, almost 2,000 feet of elevation change on the property. And Hagen builds his home on the property, and interestingly, kind of two stories below the house, like a cut and cover building, was where Hagen made his wine, so his cellar. And of course, his wines were known as Cedar Knoll Vineyards.
Okay.
After years of, about 10 years later, this was in 1876, he established a property. By 1888, he summoned the courage to send a sample of that to the Paris tasting, and actually won one of the first recorded accolades ever given to a Napa red wine by the French, which was a silver medal Paris tasting 1888. It was a big moment for him. And he did very well for himself, but unfortunately the property never survived Prohibition. So what makes this place so unique, and that happened to a lot of people in the valley, of course,
right. You know,
a lot of estates were kind of dismantled after Prohibition, but what makes this place unique is that there was only one owner between him and us. And so essentially, we were able to retain the property's original footprint. And although there were no vines planted in those 70 years between we were able to kind of stumble upon sort of the last forgotten winery in Napa right. Valley, and then have the privilege to resurrect it. And so it was a tremendous opportunity for us to be able to get to do this.
Nice. So we'll kind of go through really from the beginning where you had done the tour. We went up to all the way to the top and took a look at the vineyards, and you were describing the differences between what the, I guess, the standard UC Davis model is in planting vineyards and how you all did what you did. So.
Right. Well, I think it's a very defining aspect about this property mm-hmm. is the fact that our vineyards are planted very much around this very sort of terroir-centric model, where we delineate the vineyard's shape not based on efficiency, but rather based entirely upon the subsurface, the soil type. And so we dotted the property with thousands of core samples and delineated the vineyard exactly where the subsurface would dictate. And doing this across three major elevations, 57 acres total, created this very unique kind of terroir expression that then absolutely demanded that a winery be created that could uniquely maintain them separate mm-hmm. through the whole winemaking process. So we call this a zero consolidation winemaking technique. It's kind of unique in the fact that our goal is to allow the winemaker to define the wines at the time of blending without any premature consolidation of all these wonderful ingredients that they get to produce.
Okay, and so we were actually talking about how that's somewhat similar to what they do in Bordeaux. I mean, it's not...
It's true. If you look at a satellite image of Bordeaux, mm-hmm. the vineyards are not necessarily all rectangles. They also, right. they too, I think, vary, you know, more than 1,000 years of winemaking will do that to you. You tend to understand your soil types very well.
Right. And they didn't do a bunch of core samples.
Not a bunch of core samples, but I'm sure they dug a lot of holes. And yeah. they understand the boundaries of how the deposits were made. And their subsurface is probably very well understood. I mean, look mm-hmm. at their AVA structure as a big right. dignitary of that. And here, the more the Davis model dominated the techniques, we tend to build vineyards that are both efficient in design. In other words, they can be farmed, you know, all the rows line up, and we tend to create kind of equidistant level little rectangles, and we tend to farm them all in a row. But of course, nature does not deposit soils exactly in that format. And so having a little more sensitivity to looking how the soils are deposited, the original alluvial fans, and you know how those boundaries were created, you know, thousands and tens of thousands of years ago, understanding how Napa Valley was created mm-hmm. allows us to be a little more sensitive into creating unique parcels, planting optimized rootstocks, grafting optimized clones that the winemaker is interested in, and then of course picking a row direction that's optimized to that plant's solar needs. But then understand that at the edge of the road, the vineyard next to it doesn't necessarily have to copy that vineyard's attributes.
Right.
It can be its own unique place. And that's the whole concept of this property.
Yeah, like the French have had all this time to kind of figure that out by trial and error, basically. And you try to do that and just not take hundreds of years to figure out the same thing.
Right.
Yeah.
So I think that is kind of what definitely segued into the design of the winery first and foremost. So in order to have, you know, we have roughly 24 of these unique regions across these three major elevations, we needed a facility that could essentially almost act like 24 wineries within one. And that primarily is the reason this place is so big, north of 110,000 square feet all underground to accomplish this kind of one meaningful goal, which is to avoid consolidation, allow the ingredient to arrive to the blending table 2 years later as its own individual thing.
Okay.
And so that kind of dictated the winery's footprint. But of course, the second factor is that we practice all of this in a gravity flow concept, which is what made the winery so enormously tall. And so to kind of explain that, imagine that our winery is about 240 feet tall. It's about an 18-story building sort of stuffed into Mount George, which allows us to do kind of a non-compromising approach to gravity flow. So from grapes to bottle, a pump never touches this wine in the entire process. So we allow the wine's very complex, as is referred to as a living liquid, all the molecular structure of the wine to be sort of unimpeded by the turbulent effect of using pumps. And so we avoid them altogether by allowing wine to flow from point A's to point B's without being agitated.
Right. And without getting into the super technical stuff, that's really just so that the polymer structures don't get agitated.
Of course. And so what I mean by the molecular structure of the wine, I mean mostly because of an important discovery that was made, that tannins in wine, not to get too complicated here, but tannins were discovered to be polymerizing structures. And so when we talk about polymers in wine, we're of course referring to tannins.
Right.
And how those affect our palate and the way we perceive the wine's texture.
And, you know, it's funny because when we were talking about this and getting to the technical side of things, you had reminded me that we call them tannins because those polymers are tanning
the proteins,
right?
Yeah, which our mucosa happens to be covered in, right? So that's of course why we perceive that the feel of the wine, and it's not a taste; it's technically a feel. And of course, we have a word for that, where we would call it astringency, right? Mm-hmm. The textural quality of wine,
right? And I mean, I had just read about this, you know, just reminded myself, you know, or rereading or relearning about tannins and tanning leather. And, you know, that's where the word had come from. And I completely really forgot about it. So you brought it up in the description. And as you said that, I thought to myself, that's right, it's like tanning leather. And that's why we call them tannins.
Right.
You know, and earlier, you know, I was talking to my dad about stuff. We were discussing structure, and this is on last week's interview too. But I won't go into the whole thing. But he had asked me about wines, and I was talking about acid and tannin and all that kind of stuff. And he had asked me what tannin was. I couldn't come up with an answer. Now, gentlemen, last interview, explained it a little bit better for me. You basically just went a little bit farther with it. So, I mean, it was just interesting to be reminded what these things are.
Right.
And to kind of remember why we call these things what they are. Trust me, we haven't gotten to the super cool part yet, and I'm just excited about this. in the original introduction, I talked about how this most technologically advanced winery probably on the planet. So you've got the 24 individual parcels,
right.
And then when it comes time to harvest, you harvest them individually. I really think it was fascinating what you talked about how you accomplish the harvest or deciding when it's time to harvest. Okay.
You know, well, I've always believed this, and I think many people believe this in Napa, that perhaps the most defining moment of any wine is the point in which the winemaker decides when to pick.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that kind of definition of what a ripe berry is very important. I think that actually nothing else in the winery can affect the wine more than that single deciding factor. And so when all those sort of stars align for that winemaker and she or he says, it's perfect, so let's pick, I find it very important to be able to execute that pick and then bring those fruit into the winery and into the fermenter representing what they wanted. And a big part of that, a big part of what helps us do that is the fact that we have a full-time year-round farming crew where we're not outsourcing the farming to another company or we're not hiring seasonal labor to come in at sort of the last minute and do those picks. We're here every day. We touch these vines 35 to 40 times a year.
Right.
And we're constantly elevating that concept that the timingness, the timing and the persistence of being at the plant at the right moment. And so when the winemaker ultimately says, okay, we've accomplished the ripening we're looking for, bring that fruit into the door and then can maintain it. So we pick at night to keep the fruit nice and cool. We have a nice temperature controlled area of the winery. The fruit is parked for those critical sort of 8 to 10 hours while we're doing the destemming. And destem it beautifully, get it into the tank representing what the winemaker wanted.
Okay. So you get into the stemmer and the technology alone was just pretty, pretty amazing. And like you said, some of the stuff, other wineries do the same thing, some of it's similar, so it's not too much different, but kind of just describe how that gizmo at the end of the conveyor belt, what it does to
yeah,
accomplish
well,
what you need.
You know, the berry, if we talk, you know, if we talk about what we want in the tank, mm-hmm. what we want is basically a whole berry. You know, with no nicks, cuts, or bruises, we want the fruit to essentially be whole, not damaged. And what we certainly don't want is anything green, right? We don't want any stems or leaves. And so, you know, the stemming fruit, getting it to that point, is not easy. It takes
right.
a lot of work on the part of technology and on the human part. And there's been amazing in innovations in the last maybe decade or so with optical sorting tables and all these things. And we have a lot of those gadgets as well. But we find that, you know, when you get to work at around a quarter to half a ton an hour, you can do things that a machine can't. And so here's an example where technology can assist us. But at the end of the day, the most dexterous object in the world is a human hand.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, right.
And so we put the stemmed berries onto a very special conveyor called a six-axis vibratory conveyor. So it vibrates in a special elliptical pattern, and it causes the berries to spin on these triangular-shaped highways. And so the berry is basically moving past us about 12 inches per minute. It's very slow,
mm-hmm.
but allows us to find the berries that the destemmer accidentally, when it destemmed, it actually pulled a piece of the stem with the berry. And this little piece of wood on top, you know, allows us to remove it by hand. You know, this is the only machine in the world that will do that is a human hand, right? No,
right.
No device can physically remove that stem from that berry without damaging that berry. And this is how you improve the quality of the wine, just ever so slightly. But this, you know, of course, the ultimate goal is to have the best wine possible. These are the moments that you have to define that quality and make sure the fruit's perfect before
right.
you head into the fermenter. Because once it's in there, you're committed. That's
right.
You now have defined the best wine you could ever possibly make. Is once that fruit moves past your hands. So that's why we take that so seriously, and we'll use every minute that we can to get that fruit to the highest level quality
right.
possible.
So it goes through that, and then it goes into one of 24 tanks.
Right.
Right. So yeah, describe that part, because that was pretty amazing.
So, you know, I would say that as an industry, we're very good at destemming. I think we have some of the best technology available. I think wineries are very willing to spend big bucks in getting destemming done beautifully. And, you know, here we get this berry to the end of the process, you know, however best they can do, and then we tend to take one step backwards, sending the fruit to the tank, because in most cases the tank is never close enough, right? It's bolted to the ground halfway across the winery, and it's way above our heads. So we're used to this idea of sending the fruit to the tank. And the way we do that is typically with these augers or these conveyor belts. And so what makes it to the end of the destemming line is one thing, has one set of quality, but what makes it into the fermenter tends to be a step backwards in quality from that, because we tend to break the berry or damage the berry a little more than maybe what we wanted. So since this berry integrity is so critical to the successful fermentation of a wine and everything that goes along with that, we thought the ultimate would be to bring the fermenter to the fruit. And so we thought of this sort of like a train track full of tanks, right, with our 24 fermenters all individually sized for the vineyards I tend to. But we sort of rotate this massive carousel
mm-hmm.
and bring that fermenter so that it lines up on this balcony. So you're fermenting sort of up here, and you're dropping the fruit directly with a Teflon sleeve gently into the fermenter below that corresponds to the vineyard you're harvesting that day.
Right.
And so that kind of relationship allows to sort of continue that very precious integrity that we've worked so hard to develop on the sorting table, and then get it into the fermenter where it'll actually translate to hopefully a perfect wine.
Okay. And so now we've got them into the fermenters, and this is where some of this amazing technology is going to start showing up. And of course, you went through the whole story with us, and then you hit a button on the phone, and then this dome lights up with all this information. And we really talked about this because how we're not looking for automation and that type of stuff. It's really, this technology is really doing what? Allowing you
think of fermentation as it's going to happen with or without you.
Right.
You know, you, the winemaker, have a choice to accomplish what you intend to accomplish in these next days. You, as a winemaker, have a certain style. You have a certain plan, regardless of where you, of your training, your background, your culture, and the way you make wine. We all have an idea how we want fermentation to go. Mm-hmm. And we do our best to translate our plan into reality. And one of the things we realize, you know, when you have this level of terroir complexity out there, 24 simultaneous fermentations, it's very difficult to sort of draw the line, that very fine line where you, the winemaker, are actually making wine and controlling fermentation, and this other line where you are actually artistically creating a beautiful wine. Mm-hmm. And so you as a winemaker are sort of part nannying the fermentation,
right,
and another part creative. And we quickly realized, you know, getting to work with some of the most unbelievable winemakers in the industry, like Tina Mitchell and Mia Klein, our two executive winemakers, you work with people like this and you realize that their gift in this world has everything to do with their incredible ability to see things in wine. Things that, you know, guys like me can't see.
Right.
They have a stylistic sensitivity that is incredible. And you work with them long enough and you realize the moments in which the wine gets great is the moments they're at the tank with the only instrument they need in their hand, which is a glass.
Right.
I need that winemaker focused, plugged into the fermentation. But at the other hand, they have to manage the fermentation. And fermentation essentially is a very simple biological process of converting available sugar to alcohol over a period of time. And in a very general sense, the hotter the tank is, it tends to go faster, and the colder it is, the slower it is. So of course, most wineries, most high-end wineries, have jacket systems that can either apply heating or cooling. And they, you know, the winemaker spends an enormous amount of time basically kind of controlling that. So we set out to sort of build a system that can give the winemaker more time in front of the tank to increase that human element. So I know we sometimes think of automation as removing the human element, reducing our involvement with something. But in this case, we're doing all these efforts to increase that human involvement with the wine so that that artistic level only gets higher. So to do that, we built a very intelligent system that essentially analyzes things like Brix value using a special sonodensitometer that can measure the speed of sound inside the tank to tell us the density, which equates to its Brix. We have a very special system that allows us to thermically image the tank so that we can understand the tank's thermal state. And then we have a very advanced jacketing system that can apply heating and cooling in individual locations of the tank wherever it's needed. And all of this is done in I hesitate to say an automated format, but you are there to sort of taste and analyze the moments the wine is great.
Right.
And then steer the stylistic ship that direction. But that won't happen if you're sort of turning valves and trying to heat and cool things and setting thermostats and all that. I need you tasting the wine. So this system helps you do that. It focuses on the Brix. It makes automatic adjustments so that you're there the moment something great happens, because that, at the end of the day, that's what makes great wine.
Right.
It's only great when you're there for it to be determined that it's right. Great. And so I think a big part of what we've done, of what we've been working on the last 5 years, is having all this very information-rich environment so you, the winemaker, can make better decisions as they're needed. And so putting the data in front of you before you even need to look for it became the key. And I think that's why the dome became this very informational, rich
right.
environment where we're projecting all these thermal graphics and this tremendous level of data so that you can begin to maybe draw correlations or understand why that aroma, texture, color, or flavor showed up now, and why wasn't it here 30 minutes ago?
Right.
Why wasn't it here 3 days ago? Right. I'm trying to help you kind of get to that conclusion so that you can make better choices about this fermentation moving forward. And that's what it's all about.
And I think that's the big takeaway with this is, like you said, it's not automating something. It's using technology to free up time for that winemaker to focus on the winemaking and not the fiddling with things, you know?
I'd say that's exactly right, yeah.
Now, I didn't ask this when we were doing the tour, but so was the thought of the dome being the projection screen, was that from the beginning, or was it like, hey, we have a cool way to project this once you started getting into that?
You know, back in 97, when we started to, on paper, design this process, the technology wasn't even close enough to accomplish a pixel space like that.
Right.
And that was an enormous technological effort to sort of create this seamless wall of light, so mm-hmm. to say. And we didn't build the dome for that purpose. We built the dome for the purpose of housing the carousel. I think it was just an innovative use of the space so that winemakers didn't have to be hunting through 240 hours worth of information on something the size of an iPad.
Right, yeah.
And trying to, you know, cue that very important, you know, artistic thought or creative moment in that critical part of the fermentation. So we wanted them sort of engaged with it. Mm-hmm. And I think the dome allowed it, the technology to sort of get out of their way a little bit and let them just go right back to that sample valve, because at the end of the day, it's putting this glass to that sample valve and getting that thing into your senses so you can start to think about what's maybe happening mm-hmm. and what you're going to do next.
Okay.
And I think the dome allowed for that to occur. And I can't think of a better way to do it now. So
right, yeah, exactly. Well, it was. I can tell you when we were at that point in the tour, it was real impressive. I really was waiting for the moment when it was going to happen. One, because I mean, I already had seen the presentation, so I already knew that that happens. But have my dad there to see it, because I didn't really explain exactly how everything was. I think I did mention about a dome and things projected. I think I mentioned that, but he didn't. He probably didn't know exactly what I was talking about. But just to see the reaction, and see it live too. I mean, just to see it pop up. I mean, it was great. And I made a comment that, you know, if I had those types of resources, that is the type of thing that I would have available to my winemakers. Again, to make it so that they have the ability to make those decisions, not to automate the process, but to understand the process.
Yeah.
You know, use technology in a way to understand things and to think of it that way. Because, you know, I've said a million times, I'm not a winemaker. I couldn't do that type of stuff. But I could do something like maybe literally that. But I could do something along the lines of giving somebody else the assistance what they need rather than being the winemaker themselves.
Well, I think it's not unusual to sort of see that response from industry like yourself, because I think, you know, we all understand the difficulties with fermentation, the uncertainties that can occur. Let's keep in mind, I mean, this is a very complicated biological reaction happening in the tank, and a lot can go wrong, and having more information in this case does not hamper at all the artistic part of winemaking. And in fact, in many ways, when things do go unplanned in fermentation, that's when the winemaker needs to switch to mm-hmm. the sort of the nannying phase and try and fix things. And I think it's distracting. So at the end of the day, it's just quality control.
Right.
We're just trying to control a product's process and let the creative process be sort of unhindered. And I can't stress that enough.
Right.
That is everything we're trying to do here.
And it's I'm going to imagine that it helps with not having, you know, the old stories of winemakers sleeping in you know, in the fermentation area, literally like waking up every couple hours to test, you know, and for a month or however many days they decide their fermentation needs to be, not getting any sleep. You know, oh, and I'm sure this helps monitor that type of stuff.
This is very, you know, there's one thing I cannot put a number to is how does it taste?
Oh, no, true. You know? Exactly.
And so, yeah.
And let's hope, and I don't think technology, at least in our lifetimes, will ever get to that point. It's just too, there's too much of a artistic thing that the computer mind just can't connect yet, you know. I don't know if we'll ever do it, but.
And it's not a goal. Right. I don't think anyone's working on that. You know, we're all here to paint a painting.
Right.
And I think of these, you know, we all think of these kind of 24 parcels that turn into each of the free run and the press that go into the barrel ingredients and all that. It's like we're trying to make colors. And at the end of this process, we all get to sit down at a table and at the blend, with the available colors we have, paint this hopefully beautiful painting. Mm-hmm. But if things go wrong and you lose the color red, suddenly your painting is going to be a little lacking. Right. And some colors are worse to lose than others.
Right.
But we try not to lose any. And you know, my winemaking team certainly expects of me to avoid that happening. And that's what I mean by quality control.
Mm-hmm.
There is a way to do this, I believe, where nothing gets contaminated, where no mistakes occur, and we accomplish what the winemaker actually intended to happen.
Right. So now we go through fermentation. So that's done. And then, so take me to what's the next step in the process.
So next step is to drain. So the tank, you know, winemaker comes in and says, okay, this fermentation is completed. We usually start with a 5-day cold soak, and then however long the fermentation is actually going to occur, then we extend macerate for about a week or two. And then the wine drains. We drain the free run out of the tank. This is whatever the wine's going to flow out of the tank on its own and into a special tank that's basically a holding tank. And then we press the skins using a very unique machine that sort of takes the press wine out of the skins into a second. You don't want to blend those because you, the winemaker, may want to work with them as an ingredient later on. And then from there, after they've been deemed about 48 hours later to be perfect and have completed a successful fermentation, we then send them to their array of barrels. And so barrels are stored like a giant wagon wheel on two levels that are sort of mirror images of each other, about 40 feet apart from each other. And so level three stores actually the second year's, and then level two, the one actually below, a little counterintuitive, that stores the first year. So right now 2014 goes down to level two, goes into its array of barrels. And the unique thing here is that since we never combine a drop of wine from any barrel together, the winemaker gets to design and sort of build any array of barrels you want. So, you know, of course, of all the coopers we use in from France and all the unique forests that those trees grow from and the toasting techniques those coopers use, think of it like a spice rack of barrels. And so the winemaker gets to build this kind of array of different barrels to work with, and then she can, get to 1 year later, get to go in and taste those and build, opinions about what happened. And then, of course, most importantly, make adjustments for the second year. And that's why we have that second level.
Okay.
And that allows us to do that. So then, of course, 1 year, 2 years later, at the end of the second year, the winemaker is presented with all the available ingredients. And then, of course, they make that wonderful blend. And then replicating that blend is a whole another story. So that
right.
complexity is enormous. Now we're not talking about 8 ingredients anymore. We're talking about almost 300 unique ingredients the winemakers get to work with.
Right. And you were talking about how when they in the lab they've created that recipe.
We can call
and
it
now
a recipe.
You have,
sure.
Yeah. And you have to replicate that now on a larger scale.
You know, that's the problem. I think winemakers. Are very gifted in the fact that they get to work in a laboratory setting with perfect samples. So, you know, those guys have micropipettes. They can talk accuracy at levels that we seldom actually can replicate in the cellar.
Mm-hmm.
And I can't tell you how discouraging it is to a winemaker to make one incredible bottle of wine, you know, in her setting, and then what comes off the bottling line tastes totally different. What are we here to do? You know,
right.
If we can't recreate what the winemakers work so hard to do, this is a waste of time. And so most wineries, of course, by this point in the process, they've kind of already consolidated a lot of their ingredients, so they're not talking about the level of complexity we are. And to overcome those accuracy issues, we've had to create a lot of technology around the blending process to allow us to build everything so we're microliter accurate, and we're doing it in one batch so that every bottle of wine that rolls through the bottling center is going to basically be of the same batch. It's the same product.
Right.
And it's always a big moment for me personally when I see my winemaker try the first bottle that rolls off the bottling line, the one that we call the first production run. And that bottle, of course, should match with exquisite precision to the one she developed mm-hmm. in her setting.
Right.
And that's a big rewarding moment for us because that we know we've completed that process. In other words, that vintage is now hopefully preserved in the state that they tried to create it.
All right. And I just, you know, the whole process has been, you know, how you've described it has just been pretty incredible. Just the fact that you're not using any pumps. And we were talking about filtration and how you handle that, because there's filtration and you're at the, you know, what, half micron level, you know, a little geeky there, but the half micron level to try to eliminate the particles and stuff like that. And you're going to have to take me back, because we talked about this near the beginning, that's something that you're not doing right or you're trying to avoid.
Well, so, you know, filtration of wine is tricky mm-hmm. because, you know, especially in a gravity flow setting. Because in gravity flow, of course, the whole principle is to avoid the use of pumps, right? And avoid the use of turbulence or shear on the wine at all costs, right? Because we want to preserve, of course, these tannin polymers and other complex molecular structures. And we find out that we have, you know, we get to this process. The winemaker develops the blend. We make the blend, and prior to bottling, of course, there's one step left, right? Which is filtration.
Mm-hmm.
And we want to get this wine filtered. But unfortunately, to put wine through a half micron filter requires an amazing amount of pressure.
Right.
And so most gravity flow wineries, of course, are like two-story structures because they move wine from point A to point B with an elevator of some kind. But what they have trouble accomplishing is filtration without using pumps. So pumps have to come back into the mix. And that turbulent effect of moving wine through not just one filter, but many filters as we go from 1,000 micron all the way down through the different steps. How much damage is caused in that moment, which, by the way, is after you, the winemaker, designed the wine, is frankly kind of unknown.
Mm-hmm.
It's
right.
We don't really exactly know that. And I think that was a big key for us, designing this place. You know, here we are, we're practicing, let's call it a theory. And at the end of the day, that's all this is. You know, we're here to create a wine in a very gentle environment, and we had problems with this concept that we would get sort of 99% of the way there. The winemaker would design the wine, and then we would use pumps to filter it. What that was doing to potentially change the wine, like I said, is unknown.
Right.
So the height of the facility, you can actually argue, is only for that single part of the process. The 130 feet from level 3 to level 1 is the right height. At around 2.3 feet per PSI, to give us the right pressure to filter in one step through a very special custom filtration system that gets us all the way through our filtration and into the bottle in one fail movement. And that allows us to sort of complete the philosophy, getting the wine into the bottle. You know, as like we always say, no mistakes, no contamination.
Right.
And preserving, of course, what the winemaker wanted. And so
it's a little overwhelming. I've heard it now twice. So I kind of understand the process a little bit. And then having seen the process, I mean, it's just, it's still a lot to take in, and it's pretty amazing. And we're going to have some, probably throughout this process, we've probably thrown some graphics up. So hopefully, so you can kind of see what we're talking about here. But
it helps to be here to understand this.
Yeah.
It's difficult to talk about.
Right, because you're trying to imagine out there, you're trying to imagine how this process works. And if you haven't seen it, Even if you haven't seen pictures of it, it's kind of hard to really picture what it is versus how other wineries do it.
Right.
Well, I mean, I think it's kind of time to get into some wine here. I think we've kind of described it enough.
I think we've talked about it enough. So what I think what we're gonna try today is I'm gonna take you through some fun wines that we make.
Okay.
And then get into I think what we're known for,
right,
which is our cabs, and then we prepared some pairings to kind of go with them left to right. But we'll start with this guy here on the left.
All right.
And this is a wine. It's a Riesling, and it's a dry Riesling. Grows at our coldest part of the property, it's a unique technique in which we ferment in a cold format. So we ferment around 45 degrees, very, very long, cold fermentation.
Okay.
Sort of to try and mimic the Alsatian styles of a Riesling. So you can kind of think maybe Alsace here, but then couple that with some, big sun-drenched California Riesling fruit at high altitude.
That's some pretty darn good Riesling. I don't think I've ever had a Riesling like that. And this is in a good way. Sometimes people will say that and they're just trying to be nice and say they don't like it. They use the word interesting and they really mean they don't like it. But no, this is,
I'll tell you, somewhat
of a uniqueness to that that's really appealing.
There's a reason why we don't see this more in California. And I think it has a lot to do with the where it grows.
Okay.
I'll throw this graphic up for us, and I'm sure you can share this with the viewers. But so our Riesling here, this is the whole property, and so the pink color, the three major elevations, sort of from left to right on the screen, are the 300 foot elevation, and then the 1200 and the 1400 foot at the peak, all in red there. That's Cabernet.
Right.
Though the pink color there at 1200. Is where the Riesling grows, and that actually, that particular part of the property receives actually the least amount of sunlight, because the sun kind of comes up over the mountain in the morning and then sets on the other peak in the afternoon. So it's almost about an aggregate of about 40 minutes less sunlight per day,
okay,
and about 13 degrees average cooler. And because of that, the Riesling has a unique growing season. And it allows us to ripen the fruits slowly to sort of get rid of all the herbaceous quality early on, but not have to take it to some immensely high bricks to do that. So we can kind of have this restraint in the style of the wine, so it doesn't have to be this over-the-top, kind of crazy Riesling. It can allow to be what I think, or what I love really of the Alsace region, is the restraint they have, that the wines are beautiful in a subtle way. And I think that's what we're trying to go for with
right.
these wines, is to not be too aggressive with the aromatics or too aggressive with the palate, but let the wine sort of deliver very gently across the palate. I think in that regard, it makes it a wonderful food wine. It's really a fun wine to pair with different things from spicy to savory to, it does a lot of, it's a great accompaniment.
Right. And I don't get like this abundance of citrus lemon type of thing. I mean, I get other types of flavor profiles, but it's very much, kind of more, I guess, spice. I feel like it's more spicy, with spices than having that fruit-driven palate. And I mean, it's pretty
amazing. What we found, of course, we're drinking a 2012 here.
Right.
If you can hide this bottle from yourself, aging these wines, we found have been amazing.
Right,
and we are picking up in some of the old. I think we had a bottle of an 06 Riesling recently at home, just with the family. And my sister was saying that the wine's developing this entirely, the famous sort of petrol.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And I know sometimes that's off-putting, but you have to try it.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, as you as a psalm know what I'm talking about. But that's a characteristic that is nowhere found in this wine today, I would say.
Right.
And it just appears at around the 2, 3, 4 year mark. It's just remarkable
right.
to me that the wine can just develop that characteristic really out of nowhere. And I think only Riesling can do that.
And so before we get too far into the wines, we've done some food pairing stuff, right?
Yeah.
So is the very first one here?
So the first one is a little it's an Alaskan smoked salmon with a wasabi infused caviar, but it's not very powerful. It has a little creme fraiche base on French bread star. And
okay.
just to kind of give a little bit of the play with a little bit of the spice and give some of the textures and savory qualities that I think the Riesling can pair well with.
All right. Now, before we got into this, we talked about food pairings, and I kind of thought this was salmon, but I thought maybe it wasn't. And so long-term viewers of the show know I do not like seafood. But I have, in the interest of understanding food pairings, when seafood has been presented to me, I have tried it. So don't be surprised if I make faces or
things. I will say
but I will try it.
I will say that the second one, I think it pairs equally as well with the Riesling.
Okay.
And it's the one we prepare for the Chardonnay, but you can be the judge.
All right. So we're going to try this salmon. I'm going to have my spit cup handy in case I need to spit it out. So, or maybe I'll swallow it.
We'll see.
We'll see. Everyone yells at me because I don't try stuff. I'll swallow it, but I can still tell it's seafood. But I mean, the wasabi, okay.
And it's subtle, right? It's not mm-hmm. like it's not like wasabi. But when you bite into the roe, you get that sense of that little bit of wasabi infusion, and then with the creme fraiche, it just gives it enough of the sort of the fat on the tongue to let the Riesling kind of come alive. I mean, I think the Riesling kind of becomes a different animal with a little bit of food in the palate.
Well, I can see the pairing, and you know what the Riesling did for me? It really helped with the flavor as far as, I mean, it paired and then it washed everything away for me, so it's not too bad. But I can say, yet again, I have tried seafood and still am not a fan of it, but it wasn't that bad. I wasn't having any type of involuntary reactions, and I got it down. Let's put it that way.
As long as you're not allergic. That's
no, I'm not allergic. I'm not allergic to really any food, or at least severely allergic to any food. So we're good on that. All right. So move on to Chardonnay.
So the Chardonnay, this is a kind of a interesting story. So the Riesling, and this is a bit of a theme. You know, the wines have names. And if you look at the bottles, you'll see it says, Palmaz Vineyards, and it says Louise Riesling.
Okay.
And then the Chardonnay is Palmaz Vineyards Amalia Chardonnay. And so Louise is actually my wife's middle name.
Okay.
And so we've kind of made the Riesling in honor of my wife, Jessica. And this tradition was started really by my mother. And so when we talk about the Chardonnay, it's really my mother who wanted the Chardonnay to exist. And so she really kind of designed the wine and really directed the winemaking team into I think what we've ended up with today. The Chardonnay is done in a unique, what we call Sourdis technique. This is a technique you don't often find anymore, where we whole cluster press the grapes, mm-hmm. put the juice into the barrel. We co-inoculate yeast and malolactic bacteria, right? It's a common process done in Chardonnay. And we do them together, but we do this in a unique room that is actually sort of like a wind tunnel. And we actually bring the ambient temperature quite down so that we can coax a what is known as a symbiotic process between the yeast and the malolactic bacteria to occur. And this is a process that occurs naturally in northern parts of France, in Burgundy, mm-hmm. of course, right? So the Burgundians practice this technique, and their Chardonnays have always had this kind of beautiful balance to them. They're not too oaky, they're not too buttery, they seem to be just right. But when we say the words 100% malolactic, I think many people sort of assume instantly, you know, a butter 2x4 cocktail.
Right, yeah.
And that it is sometimes true if the process is done indifferently. And the problem with Napa Valley is that we're a little bit warmer than the ambient temperature that's needed to do this. And of course, in northern Burgundy, where it's sometimes snowing at this time of year, it's quite cold. It's these very old, you know, poorly insulated buildings that when they used to just do the same process, you know, 400, 600 years ago, the technique would occur naturally in this way. But in Napa, of course, with a little bit of technology, we can coax the exact same technique to occur and recreate the beautiful Sourdly style Chardonnay, which, of course, is done in a very tight grain, Dargo, wet sand toasted barrel, which are very, very special barrels that allow the wine to have this very subtle oak exposure. And I think about these barrels a little bit like a salt shaker with a very small hole.
Okay.
You know, just kind of lets the winemaker gently add the oak to the wine without it becoming a prevalent feature. And I think a big part of that is also you see the wine's paleness. It doesn't really pick up a lot of color from Chardonnay is one of those wines if it is aged in oak at all, you can almost judge it by its color. If it's that real amber color, you can almost know it's going to be super oaky. But in this case, this very pale color, either it was tank fermented, or it was barrel fermented in very tight grain, probably very high quality barrels.
Okay.
And I think so. When you try this wine, it might bring you back to some of the Burgundian wines you've had recently, and you think about that kind of again that restraint, not going over the top. And my mother, you know, growing up in Argentina, not necessarily exposed to California Chardonnays, for her, Chardonnay is synonymous with Burgundian style.
Right.
And so by no surprise, when she asked us to develop a white wine program, a Chardonnay program, she wanted Burgundy. Wanted this, exactly this. And so we had to build that special room in the winery just to practice this technique. Now, unfortunately, because of its method, we can only make a very small amount of this. We top out at right around about 1,200 cases right now.
Okay.
So the pairing with this wine is an edamame puree.
All right.
With a black sea salt on top of a French bread toast point, and so it plays again with the same kind of the olive oil and the texture of the edamame. It's a kind of a nice pairing with the Chardonnay that's not too overbearing.
And before I get into the food pairing, I mean, I completely get the Burgundian style out of this.
Yeah.
Okay. I mean, if this was a blind, I would absolutely take this to Old World. I mean, I don't think I would ever think of this as a New World Chardonnay. I would totally take this to Old World. I mean, since I've had some white Burgundian wines recently in the past couple months, the memory is there, so I know what they tend to taste like. I would say that you've achieved that goal is to make something of that type of style in Napa.
Yeah, well, you know, Tina Mitchell, our winemaker, she had an enormous experience, you know, working under Andrew Chelichoff. She brought this element element to the Chardonnay program that is really remarkable, and we thank her every day for having pulled this off, because I'll tell you, it's very challenging to pull off a fermentation like that in a room that is controlled, everything must go perfectly. In some ways, I think Tina sometimes sweats the Chardonnay almost more than the Gretz, because if anything goes wrong, the Chardonnay's fermentation will be totally ruined. Those doors must stay closed. The temperature must be consistent in there.
And the pairing is really good, especially with the combination of that salt. Mm-hmm. You know, getting that little salinity in with the wine, I think really emphasizes, it almost makes me feel like I'm dealing with something of Loire Valley with Muscadel and that the western part of Loire with the salinity of those wines and having oyster shells and all that kind of stuff. I mean, I think that pairing really kind of emphasizes that. And then just the overall, just it's good. I mean, yeah. I would never think about having this in my life. I mean, well, I've had it, but I would never think about having this as a pairing.
Yeah.
But the fact I took a second bite means I actually enjoy it.
You know, visitors... Our customers will tell you that as they come back to the winery again and again. We put a lot of work into the pairings. We try to change them frequently with the seasons, and we have this wonderful garden on site, and we try to work with what's fresh. And it's fun to try the wines with so many different angles. And I think it's great for us to try the wines both with food and sometimes without, and see how, you know, because at the end of the day, I believe that's what consumers are here to do. They're here to judge the wines as if they were having them in their own home,
right,
which is always probably going to be with food.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, most of the time you're going to have wine with food. I mean, there are wines that you can drink by themselves, but you know, at the end of the day, you know, wine's there to be enjoyed or consumed with a meal.
Right.
It was purified water. You know, or at least, you know, water that wasn't contaminated, so you weren't going to die from drinking it. And I mean, so you wanted to have something that tasted great and went with your food, whatever if it goes together, if it grows together, it goes together type of philosophy,
right,
too.
Absolutely.
So, I mean, yeah, I mean, our first night here in Napa, we went to an Italian restaurant. We tend to go to Italian restaurants the first night we're anywhere. And I took a picture of a Italian wine, and I had some people ask, well, why are you drinking Italian wine when you're in Napa? And I said, because I'm at an Italian restaurant.
That's right.
Okay. And I'm going to have enough, Napa wine over the next week. So it's not like I'm really going to be, you know, it's not like I'm not going to have it. I mean, I'm going to be visiting a lot of wineries, drinking a lot of great wine. So I wasn't really worried about having a Napa cab.
You're not going to ruin your palate because you had a wonderful Barolo.
Yeah, and that's exactly what I had, a Barolo. And, still have a little bit left of the hotel and finish that off. But yeah, drink the wine that makes sense.